Okay, everybody, and welcome back to another episode of Porkins Policy Radio. As always, I am your host, Pierce Redmond, and you can find all of my work by going to porkinspolicyreview.wordpress.com. And if you are a new listener, and I know that we've got lots more every time, then please do go back and check through the archives. We've got lots of great episodes, very in-depth reports. We've got wonderful guests on, and we cover a wide variety of topics. So I would really encourage you all to go and check those out. But anyway, I think we'll get into today's episode because we're going to be dealing with quite a lot of information and a lot of different little points and lots of different players, and it's a really important topic, the one that we're doing today. And for this, we're going to be focusing on TOR, which is the Onion Router, which has been around since the mid-1990s and has sort of become the sort of go-to service to use in order to remain completely quote-unquote anonymous on the internet. And it's, this is supported by all sorts of, as we'll see, sort of nefarious characters and whatnot. But recently, there was an article that was published on pando.com, Pando Daily, and it was written by Yasha Levine. And the title of this article was, "Almost everyone involved in developing TOR was or is funded by the U.S. government." And when I saw this article, I was pretty excited, actually, because this is sort of my major criticism, and there are others, and we'll get to some of those. But the sort of major criticism behind TOR is that it was started and funded by the Pentagon and by the CIA as well. And this is something that sort of is sort of brushed aside when people are talking about TOR, and this is sort of seen as, well, yes, this happened at one point, but this isn't the case anymore. So I thought this article would sort of go into this and sort of break that down and talk about, why is Snowden promoting TOR and other things like that. But unfortunately, the article didn't really go there. And in fact, Yasha Levine at the end of this Pando article kind of says, I don't know what all of this means, but, maybe you will. And he even went on Peter B. Collins' show on Boiling Frogs Post and sort of said the same thing, and I was a little disappointed, so I thought I'll try and piece some of these pieces together and try and make sense of what's going on here and all of these different groups that are supporting TOR. But let's start first with the Pando article itself, talking about TOR's funding. Because in one sense, it is a good article in that a lot of people read Pando Daily, and a lot of people will be coming to the conclusion that TOR is in fact a tool of the U.S. government, and always has been, in a large degree. Now, of course, if you do, take the time and go to TOR's own website, and I'll provide a link to this, you can see that they mentioned that they were funded by the Navy, specifically the Naval Research Laboratory, which was part of the Office of Naval Research. And along with this, they were also funded by that wonderful little group called DARPA, which I believe, I'm sure the listeners are somewhat familiar with. Now, but of course, let's assume that a lot of people aren't visiting the TOR website. So instead, they did open up this Pando article on their browser, and they started reading, and it's a little, shocking. But basically, we've got the TOR's origins dating back to 1995. And as I said, this was through the Naval Research Laboratory and DARPA. And the three leading scientists that were initially involved in this were all military mathematicians. Their names were Paul Severson, Michael Reed, and David Goldschlag. Now, basically TOR, and Levine goes into this a little bit, but essentially TOR was created so that there could be some sort of anonymous system that spies and spooks could use, something that they would be able to log on to and not have somebody checking on them. Because essentially, if it doesn't take a very sophisticated hacker or criminal or what have you, spook from a evil country to be able to go through your internet history and whatnot and see that, oh well, this guy's logging into such and such a server and it's got this sort of IP address, so this is a Pentagon guy, this is a CIA spook. So that's the sort of genesis of TOR. Now, in 2002, TOR moves into a more active stage. And this is when the DARPA contracts out. And this is where we get the introduction of Nick Matherson and Roger Dingleden. And these are both MIT graduates. And of course, MIT grad school is a breeding ground for the military-industrial complex. So this shouldn't be too much of a surprise. Now, Dingleden was instrumental in pushing the notion that TOR, in order for TOR to work, it needed lots of different people all using it, and that this would make it truly effective. Because if you've got only spooks using it, well, then it's pretty easy to kind of figure out what's going on. But if you get a whole wide variety, if you get spies, if you get people like those who use the Silk Road, so you've got, you know, people purchasing drugs, you've got internet activists, you've got people who are simply don't want their medical information to be known to everyone on the internet. And of course, other nefarious characters like child pornographers and whatnot, this TOR attracts all of these. But basically, Dingleden was very into the idea that if we got enough, you know, if you get enough people all using TOR, then the spy or whomever can kind of blend in. So he, you know, begins pushing this. Now, important to note, this whole time, they're being funded by the military. And as we'll see, Dingleden is sort of plays both sides of this and will, you know, play up the idea that he is this internet activist who cares about freedom and, you know, people like Barrett Brown, but at the same time was taking in quite a hefty, you know, check from the government. Now, again, this is more or less public knowledge, but TOR sort of, the people around the TOR project are not very, you know, upfront about this per se, or they sort of skirt around the subject. Now, 2004 marks the sort of official ending of naval funding and the start of funding coming from a group that we are going to really explore in this episode. But for right now, we're just going to kind of leave it. But this is the Electronic Frontier Foundation, or EFF. And 2004 marks when EFF begins funding the TOR project. Now, in their press release for this, they never once mention the fact that TOR is a product of the military. They, you know, just omit this little fact and instead talk about how wonderful TOR is and how we need to support it. And, you know, it's really just this fantastic tool that will anonymize everybody. And it's really great. Now, keep this date, 2004, in the back of your head, because it's going to be very important. But moving on a little bit from 2004, we enter into a more sort of sophisticated stage and a little bit more complicated world of government financing. Now, eventually, in 2006, TOR is funded through Dingleden's consulting company through a no-bid federal contract. And then in 2007, and this is all according to the Pando article, and Yasha Levine does provide a lot of sourcing on this. And as I said, you know, this is all more or less public knowledge, so you can find their tax returns and whatnot. But as I was saying, 2007, the EFF sort of leaves officially funding TOR. And instead, TOR is formed into an independent 501c3 nonprofit. Now, this is when things start to get a little interesting. This is when we start to see a real sort of influx of funding coming from the government. Now, in 2007, it appears that the funding for TOR is coming from two major grants. Now, one of these, which is about $250,000, comes from the International Broadcasting Bureau, the IBB. Now, what is the IBB? Well, that is a CIA front, which operates through or under the Broadcasting Board of Governors. But the IBB runs Voice of America and Radio Marti, which are both propaganda outlets. Voice of America is a longstanding one, and so is Radio Marti, which works in Cuba, essentially. Allegedly the CIA cut funding to these groups, but, you know, I mean, I wouldn't really believe that for a second. Now, the other chunk of cash, which is around $100,000 or so, this comes from Internews, which is a, quote, NGO aimed at funding and training dissidents and activists abroad. Now, what Internews isn't quite as upfront about is that this is really an NGO that is set up to act as a pass-through grant from the State Department. So basically, the State Department gives money to Internews, and then Internews gives money to whomever. So this is just sort of a way of kind of muddying the waters about the State Department funding particular groups. Now, 2008, TOR gets $527,000, again from IBB and Internews, which is about 90% of their total funding for that year. 2009, this is increased to about $900,000, and this is coming from the State Department and IBB, and a small amount is also coming through from the Swedish government, about $38,000, and Google also gives $29,000. Now, I'm not really sure exactly why the Swedish government was giving money to TOR, and we're going to see that Sweden pops up again. So perhaps some of the Swedish listeners out there could lend a little bit of information as to why they think Sweden might be involved in this. Now, it's important to note again that Dingledon, Matheson, Jacob Applebaum, who we'll see is another big superstar in the so-called hacker movement, they were taking home very large salaries. Dingledon and Matheson were taking around $120,000 a year, and Jacob Applebaum was taking in $96,000. And as we'll see, you know, other people as well. Runa Sandvik is another major player in the TOR project, and she was taking home quite a bit of money as well. Now, 2010, again, this is the money. Now we're reaching to around $1.3 million, again, funded through the IBB and the State Department. And this only increases. Now, around, I believe it was 2011, we start to see the Pentagon, again, getting a little bit more involved. And they start using the Stanford Research Institute, which is was devised during the Cold War, and this was a military intelligence outfit that was involved in everything from MKUltra to the TOR project. And they start funding the TOR project as well. And now in 2012, TOR nearly doubles its budget, taking in $2.2 million from the Pentagon and intelligence-connected grants. I'm quoting right from the Pando article. $876,000 comes from the DOD through the SRI Institute. $553,000 comes through the State Department and the IBB. And also along during this time, $279,000 comes from the Swedish International Development Cooperation Agency, the SIDA, which is Sweden's version of USAID. So again, I really do encourage the Swedish listeners to contact me and perhaps enlighten us as to what they're doing there. Now, you know, as I say, go through the Pando article for yourself because there is more information. But essentially, you know, Yasha Levine writes this article. He's talking about, and he talks about other things as well. I mean, he talks about Edward Snowden's connection with all of this, and we'll get to that in a moment. But, you know, he's talking about all this money and blah, blah, blah. And then, I mean, essentially, then he finishes the article off by kind of saying, well, gee golly, you know, I don't know exactly what all this means, but it sure is weird, you know? Isn't that bizarre? You know, he sort of at times is insinuating that it, you know, of course TOR is used by spooks, but it doesn't really come out and say anything substantive like, well, is this whole thing just a spook operation? And so that's a little kind of disconcerting for me, and that's a major problem I have with this article and with Pando in general. They sort of, I don't want to say they're necessarily gatekeepers, but they certainly do take people to the water's edge, but they don't really want to go the next step. And Yasha Levine is very sort of hesitant to sort of mention any of this. Now, one other interesting point that he mentions in this article and in a follow-up article is the fact that Edward Snowden is a big old fan of TOR. And I think anyone who's familiar with this podcast is probably familiar with the idea that Edward Snowden is not quite who he says he is, the man who just recently is saying, yes, I am a spy, I worked with the CIA, and spying is good, and, you know, mission accomplished, we don't need to do anything. But there are several pictures of Edward Snowden with his TOR sticker and his EFF bumper sticker as well. And Levine mentions this and relates this to, where did Edward Snowden get these TOR stickers? Well, he got them from Runa Sandvik, and he mentions the fact that Sandvik met with Snowden just a few weeks before, 2 weeks after Snowden had contacted Glenn Greenwald. Now, this is referencing to a Wired magazine article written by Kevin Paulson called Snowden Crypto Party, and this was published May 21st, 2014, and this article, as we'll see, is extremely important in painting the overall picture, the official Snowden narrative. And I'll provide the link, and I would suggest that you go through it, but essentially, this is a very standard article. Paulson, plays up Snowden as a brave hero, never questions anything. He doesn't find it all that weird that Snowden contacts Runa Sandvik, who, again, is a Pentagon employee. Sandvik was taking in a lot of money while working on the TOR project, and Snowden contacts her. He uses his LavaBit email account, so it is anonymous at this point. She's not, there's no way to necessarily figure out who he is. They talk. Snowden says that, I run TOR at work, so at his NSA facility, which is interesting. But then later, he gives Sandvik his real name and his real address so that he can get some TOR stickers. And they are talking again, and Sandvik mentions, you're from Hawaii. Well, gee, coincidentally, I'll be in Hawaii, would you like me to have, we'll do a talk, and we can talk about TOR, and we can throw a crypto party. Crypto party, for anyone who's unfamiliar, is, it's a get-together where you have speakers, and they talk about how to use things such as TOR, and how to be anonymous on the internet. Snowden says, yeah, this is great. Apparently, his girlfriend films this talk. I'd love to know where this tape is. But they have this crypto party. Sandvik and Snowden meet. Sandvik says she has a feeling that he was hiding something. He mentions that he works for Dell, but that's kind of it. He leaves out that he works for Dell under an NSA contract. Sandvik, never mentions that she's hiding something and that she works essentially for the Pentagon. And, of course, nowhere in this article does Paulson reveal that TOR and Sandvik were funded by the CIA and the State Department and so on. Doesn't think that any of these circumstances are bizarre. But essentially, and I don't want to go off too much on this article, but this article is extremely important in crafting the narrative. Everything in the article paints Snowden as a hero. Paulson is quoted as saying, even when he was thinking globally, he was acting locally, talking about, wanting to throw a crypto party. oh my God, he's just so, so wonderful. And this article, like a lot of other articles, featuring Roger Dingledean or Jacob Applebaum, all paint them as these sort of maverick heroes. And Jacob Applebaum particularly does this. So there's a famous Rolling Stone article with him where they basically paint him as this cool, hip, anarchist, cyberpunk James Bond character who lives in this, empty loft, and he's got bags of foreign money all over the place and whatnot. And, much like Snowden, Applebaum is held up as this awesome, amazing, cool, alternative guy. While failing to note that him, like Sandvik and all these other people, as is exposed in this Pando article, they're all taking home a fairly large salary and working directly for the U.S. government. And, Dingledean is a little bit more upfront about this and has mentioned, in various different talks that, yes, he does work for the government, and he has consulted with them and he has worked with law enforcement. Now, Applebaum is a little bit more kind of acquiescent to kind of go out and say this sort of stuff. He's not going to, just sort of throw it out there. Really interesting, though, is that Applebaum, playing up this hip anarchist cyberpunk sort of outlook, he also, at one point in time, worked for the Qatari government on their censorship network. Not really quite what I would expect from a you know, alternative cyberpunk, you know, rebel activist. He's professed his love of Google before, and he supports the sort of typical, you know, U.S. lines in Syria and Iran. So you know, he's very about the so-called, you know, Western-oriented activists in Syria and Iran. And Applebaum is also deeply connected with WikiLeaks, which should raise other alarm bells. You know, besides with Julian Assange and whatever, that sort of limited hangout may or may not be. It's all really interesting. But I'm going to play a quick little clip from Jacob Applebaum because I think it really kind of goes towards kind of illuminating what kind of person this guy really is. And this is from a talk that him and Dingelden gave in Germany. And this was a long talk at a university, but it sort of sums up, I think, Jacob Applebaum's political and worldview.
But the thing is that if you have the tool and someone is being abused, that is, there is a child that is being abused, and you have this tool and you say, gosh, we should take care of that, we should get rid of that tool so this child won't be abused anymore. There's also someone in Syria right now who isn't maybe even fighting in the revolution or the civil war, or whatever you want to call Assad committing a genocide against people, right? If you take away TOR, you don't stop the child abuse, and you do harm the person in Syria who needs that help actively. The problem with child porn is that people are raping children. That is a societal problem.
That's the same with fascists.
It is exactly the same as fascism, and you might even say that fascists are often child rapists, based on their actual behavior, because that is violating the autonomy of another person. But the point is, if you take away TOR, you cause a net harm, because really awful people that are going to commit those crimes, those really awful people, are going to commit a pretty simple crime compared to the other more heinous crimes they're interested in. You see this with Assad and his campaign against the Syrian people right now, where more than, what, 70,000 people? Have been killed?
Okay, so aside from Applebaum sort of shrugging off child pornography a little bit there, again, we see that this, you know, super alternative, cool, cyberpunk, you know, anarchist, you know, A, believes that what, you know, that what's going on there is all Assad, you know, very contextless sort of observation there, and is basically just, you know, propping up whatever the U.S. foreign policy there. But I guess when you start looking at who's paying for his check, it's not that surprising. Now, what, you know, what's sort of going on here, and what's the sort of larger overarching thing that connects all of these people? Because yes, okay, so we've got TOR, we've got that it's funded by the military, and we've got characters like Dingelden, Jacob Applebaum, Runa Sandvik. Now what's going on here? Now we've already got Jacob Applebaum, a connection with WikiLeaks, which does sort of, you know, flow within the same sort of ideas of Snowden and whatnot. And then we've got Runa Sandvik, literally meeting Snowden, this Pentagon employee meeting this NSA employee, you know, and talking about TOR and trying to get people to go on to TOR. And it's written by Kevin Paulson of Wired Magazine. Now, at the very end of this article, Paulson has a small disclaimer where he says, you know, full disclosure, me, Runa Sandvik, Edward Snowden, Glenn Greenwald, we're all part of the Freedom of the Press Foundation. Now, what is the Freedom of the Press Foundation? Well, this was a foundation that was formed the same month that Snowden leaks all of these documents. So, you know, we've got Snowden contacting Glenn Greenwald. 2 weeks later, he's having a crypto party with Runa Sandvik, the Pentagon, State Department, CIA employee. And then the month that he leaks these documents, we get the Freedom of the Press Foundation forming. Well, we're going to go into the Freedom of the Press Foundation in just a moment, but the Freedom of the Press Foundation is a, you know, what it sounds like. It is this foundation that is supposed to sort of promote a free press. Now, who founded the Freedom of the Press Foundation is a little bit more important, and that is a man called John Perry Barlow. Now, I think, in my opinion, John Perry Barlow is really is one of the major figures in all of this, and he is the person that kind of connects all of these sort of seemingly disparate people all together. Now, John Perry Barlow, for anyone who doesn't know, is the co-founder of the Electronic Frontier Foundation. Now, he is a former lyricist for the Grateful Dead, which already should be raising some red flags and alarm bells for people. Full disclosure, I unfortunately used to be a very big fan of the Grateful Dead, and this was until I started looking into them and their connections with a whole cast of unsavory characters, including people like Timothy Leary, Bear Owsley, who is basically the foremost producer of LSD and was probably a CIA agent. And, you know, if that doesn't sort of, and he was the sound man for the Grateful Dead, and if that doesn't sort of dissuade you, we've also, you know, we've got Grateful Dead members such as Bob Weir and Mickey Hart attending the Bohemian Grove. So again, you know, and this is a theme. This is a theme that we see. We see these crazy hippie anarchist activists, and then, you know, like the musicians in the Grateful Dead, and this whole counterculture thing. You know, like Snowden and Applebaum, and then, you know, we got them going to the Bohemian Grove and you know, praying before a 40-foot stone owl. But anyway, John Perry Barlow, former lyricist of the Grateful Dead, founded the Electronic Frontier Foundation in 1990 with the goal of protecting freedom on the internet. Now, to their credit, they have done some good things. They have certainly helped to promote internet freedom. They have helped to promote, awareness about certain laws, things like, you know, CISPA and all these other ridiculous, bills that try to get rammed through Congress to limit the internet. But upon closer examination, we see that John Perry Barlow and the EFF are not exactly what they seem, and a different picture begins to emerge. Now, first off, whenever you look at any of these sort of groups, and again, EFF is very influential, you know, Edward Snowden is a big fan of them, Glenn Greenwald, all of these people, you've got to look at the funding, you know, you've got to look at who's backing these sort of groups. Now, who backs the Electronic Frontier Foundation? Well, none other than the Open Society Institute, George Soros's group, the Sunlight and MacArthur Foundation. These are massive, big foundations that give a lot of money, and these are run by not the nicest of people, or certainly people that you should be weary of. If you're getting your money from George Soros, then what does, you know, then your agenda is shaped by George Soros. But I think the most important thread to this is, for the Electronic Frontier Foundation, is in 2004. Now, remember, that was a date I said to keep in the back of your mind. December 21st, 2004, is not only the same day that the Electronic Frontier Foundation backs the TOR Project without telling anybody that it was project that is funded by the U.S. military in order to facilitate spies on the internet. December 21st, 2004 also marks the first day when the Electronic Frontier Foundation becomes a part of the Omidyar network, and that is, of course, Pierre Omidyar's foundation. That is his group. And who is Pierre Omidyar? Well, he is none other than the guy who is funding First Look Media, which is where Glenn Greenwald is, and Laura Poitras, and he is basically now in charge, controls all of the Snowden leaks, and he, of course, is a founder of eBay, he's a co-partner in PayPal, and is certainly involved in some way with the NSA spying. So this is, again, we're starting to piece these pieces together, so we get, you know, again, just to reiterate, because I know that I'm throwing a lot of information out there. We get the TOR project being funded by the military. We get the Electronic Frontier Foundation teaming up with TOR, while at the same time receiving lots of money from Pierre Omidyar, who is no doubt involved in some capacity with NSA spying. And again, the NSA uses TOR. But let's explore John Perry Barlow a little bit more, because again, he's a really interesting character. Because like Applebaum and like you know, some of these other people, like Snowden, he portrays himself as so cool and hip, and you know, I was with the Grateful Dead, and yeah, and I knew Leary, and yeah, fucking acid is so, you know, mind altering and enlightening, and a lot of this kind of baloney that gets thrown at people constantly. But John Perry Barlow is a little bit more interesting, and he penned a very revealing article in 2002 in you know, that bastion of alternative thinking, Forbes magazine. And this was, and I think it's important, again, you know, I always like to take you know, people's own words, because I think that many times can be more revealing. It's really interesting. But he writes this article, which is entitled "Why Spy?" And it's essentially his sort of take on modern-day spying, both at the NSA and the CIA. And, you know, within the third paragraph, he basically points out that he has for years, you know, contracted with various intelligence agencies. And he, you know, he says, oh, well, you know, I've the past decades or so, I've criticized and worked with the intelligence community. So interesting, you know, he's running this foundation that's supposed to promote internet freedom, and he's working with people that are not super big on internet freedom. But anyway, in this article, he talks about the fact that in 1992, he met Robert Steele, who is a pretty famous CIA officer or CIA employee who is sort of big within this movement. And, you know, I think you should always be wary of any of these CIA guys who all of a sudden are you know, super into, you know, sort of whistleblowing or promoting some sort of idea. You know, the old adage, you know, sort of once in the agency, always in the agency, I think rings true. But anyway, Robert Steele approaches Barlow. He asks him to speak at a conference of before 600 members of American and European intelligence, the intelligence community. And Barlow, yeah, sure, yeah, what the hell, yeah, no. And afterwards, while he's speaking at this conference, he's approached by Paul Wallner, who is the CIA's open source coordinator. And he wants John Perry Barlow to come by Langley and to talk with some of his people there. And, you know, John Perry Barlow, the, you know, hippie, you know, anti-establishment guy who promotes internet freedom, says, oh, yeah, sure. Well, you know, what the hell? Yeah, let me go to Langley. Let me go to the heart of the beast and talk to these guys. And a few weeks later, Barlow goes to Langley. And, you know, and he describes the CIA as this very archaic institute. You know, he says that there are teletype machines everywhere, and he talks about how they're still using vacuum tubes to transport memos and whatnot. And, you know, the CIA is so demoralized, and it's weak, and it's plagued by non-communication and incompetence and blah, blah, blah. And, of course, we've heard all of this before. This is a standard sort of approach to the CIA, and especially, you know, and when it's coming from someone who's admitting that he's worked with them or worked in some capacity with the intelligence community, it's not really a surprise. You know, the CIA is always portrayed as sort of this, it's this little, you know, organization, and they're so incompetent, and, you know, the idea that they're actually using teletype machines and all this stuff in 1993, I think, is a little bit ridiculous. But anyway, Barlow is there, and he meets with a whole bunch of different CIA employees, and he's basically talking about, you know, open source intelligence, and that, you know, and he's so surprised that the CIA isn't connected to the internet. And, you know, he kind of gives him some pointers on how they could have, you know, they could be connected to the internet for gathering open source information, and they could have a separate intranet, which is dedicated to classified data. You know, and he insists that they, you know, you got to have a website, and you know, this will really help. And then, you know, he said, you know, sort of say, oh, the internet's going to be big, you know, it's going to be huge, as if no one at the CIA would be able to predict this. But nonetheless, he does. And and then he writes a little bit later on in the article that when the CIA does come out with a website, he's, you know, he's just shocked that, you know, oh, well, you know, it's only filled with press releases and maps, and you know, there's nothing really on there. And, you know, I mean, what the hell? Yeah, you know. And then he says that Al-Qaeda's official website, which, interestingly, Barlow says is almujarun.com, which, as far as I know, is not Al-Qaeda's website, and in fact is the group Al-Mujarun's website, which anybody who's been listening to my good friend Tom Secker would know that this is a complete fabricated organization that's filled with spooks and spies and whatnot. But anyway, Barlow says this. And he says, oh, well, that website has so much more information than the CIA's. And it's kind of like, you know, what the hell did you think or expect, John, that the CIA is going to, put up the family jewels on their public website? But anyway, I digress. John Perry Barlow kind of continues on. He talks about meeting with White House staffers and saying that they're afraid of the NSA. And again, playing up this idea slowly that the NSA is, that's the real bad guy, and the CIA is okay. You know, don't worry about them. He then talks about a conference that he attended called the Intelligence Community Collaboration Conference, where the primary speaker was none other than NSA Director General Hayden. Barlow rattles off a whole slew of ridiculous assertions by Hayden, where Hayden talks about how antiquated and inefficient the NSA, without ever once questioning the veracity of any of these claims. You know, he's, and a few years later, of course, Barlow will tell anybody that will listen to him how advanced the NSA is, but then, you know, he sort of believes that they are. He just sort of paints this very, easy cookie cutter portrayal of the whole intelligence community, and throws in these little nuggets where he says, you know, all the intelligent people I met are really intelligent and thoughtful, you know, and it's secrecy and bureaucracy. That's the real problem. And he keeps kind of hammering this in, and he talks about how, you know, the problems with the CIA is that it's too big, it's too bureaucratic, and it's too secretive, and if only they could embrace, you know, open source intelligence, and if only they could be more open to the public. And then he talks about what he would envision, what his sort of dream CIA, how it would work. And I'm going to quote directly from this because it's really just completely startling, and it just makes you question, who is this guy and what is his motive here? But he says, quote, "The entity I envision would be small, highly networked, and generally visible. It would be open to information from all available sources and would classify only information that arrived classified. It would rely heavily on the internet, public media, the academic press, and informal worldwide network of volunteers, a kind of global neighborhood watch that would submit on-the-ground reports. It would use off-the-shelf technology and use it less for gathering data than for collating and communicating them. Being off-the-shelf, it could deploy tools while they are still state-of-the-art. I imagine this entity staffed initially with librarians, journalists, linguists, scientists, technologists, philosophers, sociologists, cultural historians, theologians, economists, philosophers, and artists. A lot like the original CIA, the OSS under Wild Bill Donovan. Its budget would be under the direct authority of the president, acting through the National Security Advisor. Congressional oversight would reside in the committees on science and technology, and not under the Congressional Joint Committee on Intelligence." And this goes on, and he, you know, names or dubs this institute or this organization the OIO, the Open Intelligence Office, and it sort of goes on from there. But essentially, you know, John Perry Barlow, the maverick hippie rebel, thinks that, all we got to do is just get some, you know, cool, you know, psychedelic artists and some philosophers and some sociologists and whatnot, and we just got to make it like the OSS, because the OSS never did anything wrong. You know, there was nothing like Operation Paperclip, the beginnings of MKUltra, murdering people around the world. None of that's cool. You know, the OSS was hip. You know, it had artists and cultural historians and, you know, journalists and any of this stuff. So, you know, I don't want to get too caught up in this, but, you know, this is this is the kind of guy that John Perry Barlow is. And, you know, it's not that surprising that the group that he forms, the Electronic Frontier Foundation, is the kind of group that would then team up with a project like TOR. You know, and this guy who spends so much of his time talking about how, you know, alternative and hip and how he's anti-establishment would go to the CIA and would encourage them to, you know, create this ridiculous open intelligence office. Again, as if we even need something like the OSS or the CIA, you know, as if there are these ridiculous, crazy external threats that we constantly need to fight against. So, you know, really interesting. And then again, it's not that interesting that he forms a group like the EFF that then takes money from Pierre Omidyar. And if this has not piqued your interest at all in John Perry Barlow and has made you maybe question, you know, his organization, as I said, he also founded the Freedom of the Press Foundation. And this, again, was founded the same month that Snowden leaks all of his documents to Glenn Greenwald. Now, again, who founded the Freedom of the Press Foundation? What are the connections here? Well, it's founded by John Perry Barlow, his good friend Daniel Ellsberg, who, again, if anybody takes the time to actually dig a little deep on Daniel Ellsberg, you'll see that he is not this peace-loving activist who hates war and whatnot, and he's actually very similar in many ways to Edward Snowden, in that both Snowden and Ellsberg leaked documents on one of their employers. In the case of Ellsberg, it was the Pentagon, and in the case of Snowden, it was the NSA, but neither of them revealed anything about their second employer, which was both the CIA. So very interesting there. Now, the other co-founders initially are Rainey Reitman, who is also a founder of the Bradley Manning Support Network, and Trevor Tim. And Trevor Tim used to work at the Electronic Frontier Foundation, EFF. And Reitman is the activism director at EFF. So here we go. We get this, you know, Barlow leaves the EFF to form the Freedom of the Press Foundation, but takes a lot of these same people with him. And as we'll see, it doesn't stop there. Now, who's on the board of directors at the Freedom of the Press Foundation? Michael Lee, formerly of the Electronic Frontier Foundation, who also works at The Intercept, which is the media conglomerate that has just been formed by Pierre Omidyar, where Glenn Greenwald and Laura Poitras work, and who's also on the board of directors at the Freedom of the Press Foundation. Glenn Greenwald and Laura Poitras. Also on the board of directors is Edward Snowden. So I hope that this is sort of starting to make a pattern and that things are perhaps starting to connect here. And just to kind of continue on with this, who's on the technical advisory board? Well, we've got Jacob Applebaum, the former TOR member, government employee, and WikiLeaks volunteer. We've got Ashkan Soltani, interesting guy here. He worked, he's worked for several different news outlets, but also worked for the Washington Post and shared in their 2014 Pulitzer Prize on the NSA story. So interesting, we get another guy who, you know, the Washington Post is one of the other few outlets that received this cachet of Snowden documents aside from Greenwald and Poitras. And, you know, and he works for this foundation. So interesting. Also, a full-time employee of the Freedom of the Press Foundation and also on the technical advisory board is Runa Sandvik. Oh, yes, that other TOR employee who met Snowden. And who wrote that story about him meeting Snowden? Oh, right, the other person who's on the technical advisory board, Kevin Paulson, the editor at Wired. So, you know, this is all, you know, if this is, you know, just all crazy coincidence or that all of these people wanted to work there, I think you're really not looking at the much larger picture here. You know, these, and I think we'll start to kind of sum up what we're actually seeing here. But quickly before we do that, I just want to say also, who's funding the Freedom of the Press Foundation? You know, because that's important as well. Now, there is some publicly available information on this. We get, I believe it was earlier this year, and I'll provide the links in this in the show notes, but we got a $350,000 grant spread over 2 years, so that's $150,000 for over 2 years, coming from none other than Pierre Omidyar. Ah, right. And that same year, he also gave $100,000 to the Electronic Frontier Foundation. Oh, really interesting. Now, that is the only sort of publicly available knowledge. Now, the Freedom of the Press Foundation also does, you know, crowdsource money, and they do receive a lot of money from there. But that's a fairly large chunk of change coming from Omidyar. Now, I actually contacted the Freedom of the Press Foundation through their website, asking them about any other additional foundation funding. Because, you know, you see a lot of them, you know, at times they'll sort of criticize, you know, that oh, these groups have to be independent and we, you know, we can't be subservient to anybody. Well, at the same time, they're taking these massive amounts of money from these, you know, globalist, you know, people such as Omidyar. So I emailed them and I was extremely upfront. I said, my name is Pierce Redmond. I run a, you know, alternative news site called Porkins Policy Review. I'm currently working on a story about TOR, EFF, you know, Pentagon funding, blah, blah, blah. And I am interested in any other foundation funding for the Freedom of the Press Foundation. And I said, you know, it's a little difficult online and I can't find anything. And I actually received an email back a few days later. And, you know, they were not really curt, but they were definitely kind of didn't really want to, you know, get into all of that. But they, you know, they said, oh, well, you were a little bit wrong. We didn't get $350,000. We only got $150,000, you know, because it spread over 2 years, as if that really makes that much of a difference. Now, they also, they did tell me that they received $50,000 each from two other foundations. One is the Randall Wallace Fund, and the Randall Wallace Fund is part of the Wallace Global Fund, which is from Henry Wallace, who was he was FDR's Secretary of Agriculture and later his Vice President. Among other things, you know, Henry Wallace is very instrumental in a lot of the sort of genetics of agriculture and was very deeply involved in a lot of the sort of precursor stuff to groups like Monsanto and thing, or was very involved in a lot of that kind of research, and was also a, you know, 33rd degree Freemason, and if you're really interested, also, you know, helped to convince FDR to put the all-seeing eye on the back of the dollar bill, and was a very close friend of a Russian mystic guru, Nicholas Rorick. But that is for another podcast, perhaps. Now, another $50,000 comes from the Tides Foundation, and the Tides Foundation receives millions of dollars from none other than George Soros. So, you know, all of these groups kind of, you know, all kind of intermingling together. Now, I think we've sort of maybe perhaps exhausted this, and you know, this might have been a little bit all over the place, and I hope that it is clear to people. But in kind of wrapping up, you know, why is this important? You know, what does this mean, and why does it matter? Now, on the surface, this may all look good. You know, as I said, the Electronic Frontier Foundation has done good stuff in the past. I don't want people to think that everyone that works there is necessarily evil or somehow connected with the government. But the people kind of running it at the top, people like John Perry Barlow, people like Trevor Tim, you know, some of these other characters there, they're not necessarily quite on the up and up. And that's important. And in reality, what we're seeing here is not a sort of expansion of you know, information and awareness and activism, but instead we're seeing the complete consolidation of information and influence into the hands of a very few a shady group of individuals who are also quite wealthy and quite well connected. So, you know, while this idea that having a new foundation that's promoting press freedom, oh, that's so great, but when the group is funded by Pierre Omidyar, you know, when it's funded by the one guy who's now bought off Glenn Greenwald and Scahill and Laura Poitras and Michael Lee and all these other people, and when he essentially now owns all of the Snowden documents, and he is now the guy who's paying the paychecks for these supposed, you know, objective journalists, and when he's working at PayPal, working with the NSA, when he was at PayPal, what was he doing? He was blocking WikiLeaks donations, and one of the functions of the Freedom of the Press Foundation is to provide secure drops so that you can donate to WikiLeaks. Really interesting that this guy who blocked WikiLeaks is now funding WikiLeaks, in a sense. So again, what you're really seeing is the consolidation of information and influence into the group, into, you know, a few particular well-connected people. Now, by promoting Tor, yes, Tor in and of itself is not a bad thing. I think, you know, it could be a very useful tool. I think it, you know, we can't totally dismiss it, but people like Sandvik, people like Applebaum, and all these other characters, they promote Tor like it's a religion. And anyone that disagrees with them, they castigate as, evil and as working with, you know, they're always like, oh, whose side are you on? Are you working with the government? You know, while failing to note that they took home government paychecks the whole fucking time. But by promoting Tor, we're also forgetting about lots of the other alternatives. And when these guys go on and they do these big conferences, you know, they're never talking about things like Linux. You know, they're never talking about, people like the founders of Startpage.com, which I've talked about before, which is, the most private internet search engine that you could use. Now, is Startpage necessarily the be-all and end-all answer? No. But it is another alternative. It is something else that you can use. They never mention groups like Cryptome. And I've used Cryptome numerous times, and, you know, before WikiLeaks, before any of these so-called whistleblowers like Snowden and whatnot, Cryptome was releasing way more documents, making them freely available for anyone to download. You know, you don't have to go out and buy Greenback's book to learn a little bit extra about what Snowden revealed. You know, Cryptome would just give you everything. And it's no surprise that John Young, the founder of Cryptome, has been extremely critical of people like Applebaum and Tor, and he is, you know, ridiculed by them constantly. Now, on a more sort of grand level, and I'll wrap this up here, while obviously we should all want to feel safe and anonymous online, you know, we should be able to just sort of go on and do whatever we want, I find that this whole, whatever this whole thing is, whatever Snowden is, and, you know, full disclosure, I have no problem admitting this, I think he is some sort of CIA plant or asset, or still works for the CIA, probably, and that this is really this is a psy-op designed to shift people into this mindset where they have to fear going on the internet. They have to fear everything. They want you to feel that the NSA is so, you know, all-powerful and all-seeing that you should self-censor yourself. You know, you shouldn't go look at a certain website. You shouldn't, type in certain keywords anymore because the NSA is watching you. They're going to go get you. And the only alternative is to go use Tor, which, of course, you know, is in many ways, a tool of the NSA to find you. You know what I mean? It's, you know, when the NSA is running Tor exit nodes and when they're searching it, and when the NSA, and even in some of those slides that Snowden revealed, is saying that we need more people to use it. You know, what what the hell is going on there? What are we really seeing? And unfortunately, that's what I see. I see that this is a promotion of self-censorship. This is a way of basically making everyone fearful. And, you know, what's really changed? Absolutely nothing. We just see a new law right now that trying to be passed in Australia that would criminalize anybody who leaks, you know, documents about spying and NSA surveillance. You know, we got Snowden saying, oh yeah, mission accomplished, everything is great. Oh yeah, I work for the CIA too. But you know, it's cool, just use Tor, that's safe. So a big psyop, and again, we shouldn't really be putting our faith in any of these things, in Tor, in EFF, especially in John Perry Barlow, or Jacob Applebaum, or Runa Sandvik, or any of these things. And I'll just close this out by saying, too, is that, you know, nowhere in any of these phony, you know, activists, speeches and conferences do they give you, nowhere do they say, you know what, also you could do is just flip off your fucking computer, you know, leave your cell phone at home, you know, you don't need to be connected constantly to the internet, you know, just because it's all anonymous doesn't mean that you should be on there 24/7. But anyway, I'm going to leave it at there. I think we've probably gone on for a little bit too long as it is. But anyway, lots of different things, and I promise that we're going to return to this again, because I don't think we've really seen the end of any of this. This is only the beginning. And, you know, there's still a lot to be explained about Omidyar, about Snowden, about Greenwald, about all of these various connections. You know, why are all of these groups, you know, basically one big-ass group? Why are they all being funded, you know, by the same handful of individuals? But anyway, I'm going to leave it there. You, of course, have been listening to Porkins Policy Radio. I am your host, Pierce Redman, and if you enjoyed this podcast, then please do visit porkinspolicyreview.wordpress.com, and there you can find all of the podcasts, you can find articles, you can find my appearances on other podcasts. Everything there is free to download. You can follow me, of course, through email blasts on the website. You can also follow me on Twitter at Porkins Policy, and also follow my YouTube channel, which is youtube.com/1138Porkins. And again, if you're new to the podcast and you enjoy this, then, you know, please tell a friend. If you're a longtime listener, I appreciate everything that everyone has been doing to promote the show. It's been really fantastic. And if you like this podcast, then, you know, tell a friend, put it up on your social media, you know, email it to someone, do whatever. But it really helps me out a lot, and it's really fantastic. And the numbers have just been really great in the past couple of months. And I will be talking to you very soon.